Paris. Restaurants and romance, empire and opera, fun surprising experiences at every one of the more than 300 stops on the metro. My name is Lisa. I'm a writer and tour guide. I carry a Canadian passport, but all we'll need is a ticket for the metro system as I show you historic, inspirational, endlessly fabulous Paris. I'd like to share my love for this spectacular city with you, one stop after the next, by way of the exciting Paris metro system. So grab your French phrasebook and put on your walking shoes. We're going to Paris. Next stop, Saint-Germain-des-Prés. We're going to explore the amazing Paris neighborhood of Saint-Germain-des-Prés. This is the famous left bank, the Rive Gauche, filled with famous theaters, bookshops, personalities, and churches, as well as spectacular restaurants and museums. This is an unforgettable neighborhood, important during the French Revolution, crucial for jazz, and for every kind of creative inspiration. Welcome to Saint-Germain-des-Prés, a gorgeous neighborhood named for the historic church behind me. Over the centuries, this quartier has been home to aristocrats, philosophers, writers, and artists. And today, we will explore the wonderful little streets where they have lived. The metro station Saint-Germain-des-Prés is right next to the Latin Quarter near the University of Paris. It's always been a favorite for students and artists. In the 17th century, this was the intellectual heart of Paris. By the time of the Revolution, major political figures such as Marat and Danton lived here. By the 1800s, Saint-Germain attracted painters like Delacroix and writers like Racine. During the 20th century, the neighborhood's reputation became surrealist and existential, a place for thinkers like Jean-Paul Sartre, writers like Hemingway, and artists. Even Picasso lived here for a while. It was a period of great change for Parisians who were discovering jazz, existentialism, and new forms of visual art. The area became a nourishing creative laboratory. But today, this experimental age is over. For today, Saint-Germain-des-Prés is the most expensive neighborhood in all of Paris, known for its boutiques, restaurants, and international art galleries. But traces of its wild past haven't completely disappeared. Let's walk down these legendary streets and step into these famous cafes. If you love books, this is a paradise, the heartland of French publishing with amazing bookshops, some with English books, mere steps away from the cafes. And as we walk, we'll follow in the footsteps of the great writers who lived here. The metro lets us out at Place Saint-Germain-des-Prés, which was renamed Place Sartre-Beauvoir in 2000. This in honor of the great philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre and his partner, brilliant feminist writer Simone de Beauvoir. This is a lovely square for a break. If you picked up a pastry from one of the nice bakeries in the neighborhood, you're right beside Saint-Germain-des-Prés Church, and you can sit here and admire sculptures and also some vestiges of the medieval abbey behind me. This is a memorial to the great French poet Guillaume Apollinaire, who was best friends with Picasso. Now, unfortunately, Apollinaire died tragically in 1918. Much later, Picasso offered the city of Paris a sculpture to commemorate his friend. But the city of Paris didn't like the design of the sculpture, so Picasso, in a huff, gave them a recycled piece of work. This is actually a bust of Dora Maar, a photographer lover of Picasso's. And it's her bust that is the memorial to his friend. Just down from the place and the Église Saint-Germain-des-Prés is a wonderful warren of historic small streets where over the last century many writers and artists have lived and worked. So let's go for a little exploration of the neighborhood. Saint-Germain-des-Prés is now a very nice three-star hotel. But back in the
1920s and 30s. It was just one of many so-so hotels that rented cheap rooms by the month, which was perfect for writers and artists looking to have a base in a great cultural center in the city where they would go out to cafes to eat and see their friends. Now, Henry Miller, the American writer, lived here while he was working on his infamous book, Tropic of Capricorn. Here on Rue des Beaux-Arts is L'Hôtel, which used to be a low-end hotel. And in 1900, famous playwright Oscar Wilde came here after his imprisonment. Essentially, the famous wit came to Paris to die. And in this hotel, one of the last things he said was, looking at the terrible walls of his room, "Either this wallpaper goes, or I do." This is the Rue de Seine, which was once a canal connecting from the Seine River behind me. The canal was dug by the monks of Saint-Germain-des-Prés during the Middle Ages so that the water from the river would come up this canal and irrigate their fields. The Hôtel Louisiane has been important to artists and writers for nearly a century now. Writers Simone de Beauvoir and later Ernest Hemingway both have lived in this hotel. And in the 1950s, all kinds of jazz musicians stayed here, like Chet Baker and French singer Juliette Gréco. Now today, it's still a very low-key hotel. It's owned by the fourth generation of the same family that has always owned it. And it's still in this wonderful heart of Saint-Germain. Even though you may not have heard of Natalie Barney, in her day, she was infamous for the parties she used to hold here in the garden behind the doors. Now, Natalie Barney was a Boston heiress. She wasn't a wonderful writer, but she knew everybody in Paris, French, American, any other nationality, man, woman, especially lesbians. Natalie Barney really enjoyed connecting that part of the cultural world. But basically, her Boston family had paid her to move away. So she chose to come to Paris, where she could be herself and be part of the cultural world. Now, to wrap up my tour of writers and artists in Saint-Germain, I like to finish at this doorway. This is 42 Rue Bonaparte, which is where Jean-Paul Sartre, the famous philosopher and writer, lived for a little while. Very conveniently just down the street from the Café de Magot, where he spent so many hours writing. Le Deux Magots is a cafe that opened in 1884 in the heart of Saint-Germain, and it was immediately a success. Poets like French writer Verlaine, playwright Oscar Wilde, and later Hemingway and the existentialists all hung out here. The peculiar name of the Deux Magots comes from two Asian figurines made of porcelain. For more than a century and a half, these two Chinese philosophers, the two Magots, have silently listened to all the conversations taking place at their feet. It's wonderful as a writer to sit here in the Deux Magots because it is such a literary cafe, especially because I'm sitting below the photo of writer Simone de Beauvoir. This was one of her favorite places to work during the afternoons. And actually, there's a plaque dedicated to her just here behind me. And just over here, there's a plaque to Sartre, who also loved to work here and spent a lot of time in this Saint-Germain area. I love writing in the Deux Magots because I've been coming here for years. For a little while, I even lived a few blocks away near where Picasso used to live. And I would walk over here often in the evenings to write and feel surrounded by people. It's a wonderful place to people watch, and it's really inspiring to feel that I'm here in the heart of this incredible culture, this writing culture that's been here for well over 100 years. What's fascinating about the Deux Magots is that it's part of this long history of culture in the cafes. Because honestly, back in the day, if you were a writer or artist, you really couldn't afford to heat your tiny room where you lived. So you came out to the cafes to warm up. You could spend hours here lingering over a coffee or a single glass of wine. This is where you worked, and it's also where you met all your friends because everyone knew you were in your cafe at your table. You had a real routine, you kept regular hours, and this was where the exchange of ideas took place in the arts. It's one of the reasons Saint-Germain became such a hub for intellectual ideas.
Come with me out of Les Deux Magots and across the street to the oldest church in Paris, l'Église Saint-Germain. We'll discover its hidden treasures right after this. In inspiring, exhilarating Paris, visiting the city through its metro stations, and today we're exploring the amazing Saint-Germain-des-Prés.
Saint-Germain-des-Prés is the oldest church in Paris, and actually gives the name to the entire Saint-Germain neighborhood. This used to be Saint-Germain in the fields because it was outside the Paris city walls. The church was surrounded by an abbey. The Benedictine monks worked the fields, but also read and really created a foundation of literacy which carried over into the literary history that Saint-Germain-des-Prés is now famous for.
The abbey was founded in the year 558, but the church we see today was rebuilt in the 11th century after being burned by the Vikings. During the French Revolution, Parisians stored saltpeter here, and an explosion destroyed much of the abbey, including its library. But the church survived, and worshippers returned in the more stable 1800s. Today, if you're interested in religious architecture, this church is a must-see. The Romanesque nave is the last remaining one in Paris, and the choir is early Gothic. This mix of architectural styles on the inside of a church is rarely seen so clearly in French religious buildings. The church contains the tombs of many famous people, such as the great French mathematician and philosopher René Descartes. There's also the mausoleum of the King of Poland, John II Casimir, who retired to this abbey in 1667. The first organ was installed here in 1474. It's long since gone, replaced by a new one, which was put in the early 19th century. The organ was completely restored in the 1970s, and today you can come here to listen to all kinds of classical music. These concerts are yet another reason to visit l'Église Saint-Germain-des-Prés. And while you're here, you can enjoy the amazing, unique, beautiful art inside. And after some spiritual elevation, we can go a block away to a place where the regulars weren't really saints.
The Café de Flore is one of the elegant literary cafes of Saint-Germain-des-Prés. It still hosts an important literary prize, and it does play readings upstairs in its dining room. But if you want to sit in the see and be seen part, be sure to sit in the back of the terrace or the front row of the indoor dining space.
With the Brasserie Lip and Les Deux Magots, the Café de Flore completes the holy trinity of elite VIP cultural and political venues in Saint-Germain. This café opened in 1887 and takes its name from Flora, the Roman goddess of spring, whose statue once stood on the other side of Boulevard Saint-Germain. Since the early 20th century, the biggest names from the world of literature, art, and politics have been customers here. From artist Picasso to Russian revolutionary Trotsky, and of course, Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir. As with any famous Parisian tradition, it's important to know what rules to follow. So here are my tips to make you feel like an insider. At the Café de Flore, if you order a coffee, ask for a café pot, which is served on a tray in a small pot with an empty cup. And if you'd prefer a glass of white wine, ask for La Doucette, which is the house wine. And to really feel like a writer in Saint-Germain-des-Prés, next we have to pop into the neighborhood bookshops.
This is La Une, a marvelous bookshop, which for years was between the two literary cafes, the Deux Magots and the Café Flore. Recently moved around the corner, it's still a wonderful place to pick up the latest avant-garde literary publications, poetry, philosophy, and a great place to browse.
In a rare case of literature defeating high fashion, this new location for La Une bookshop used to be a Dior boutique. Dior had taken over the space from a bookshop called Le Divan, so now La Une is having a small revenge on the luxury boutiques that have invaded Saint-Germain-des-Prés in the past 20 years. La Une is not the only literary stop you have to make in this neighborhood.
To get a real feel for the literary history of Saint-Germain, you must drop into the Musée des Lettres et Manuscrits. Here they have all kinds of original documents and handwritten letters from people like French poet Paul Verlaine and other writers, including Russian Leo Tolstoy.
The museum is located at 222 Boulevard Saint-Germain in a former private mansion from the early 17th century. Its impressive collection is a wonderful journey into history to discover surprising, intimate words from famous writers, artists, and historical figures. Here you can find not only manuscripts, scores, and important documents, but all kinds of personal letters, sometimes highly revealing, and sometimes simply about ordinary, everyday subjects. Whatever your interests, you're sure to find something to fascinate and surprise. Literature is obviously very present at the forefront of the museum. Have a look at the letters and manuscripts written by people like the author of Notre-Dame de Paris, Victor Hugo. You can even see the correspondence between the great Russian writer Leo Tolstoy and his French publisher. I want to know how anyone ever deciphered his handwriting. This is a bit of a problem for visitors because it's not always easy to read these handwritten letters and manuscripts, but it's worth making the effort. Have a look at a letter from Oscar Wilde to his biographer, or this one from John F. Kennedy to an American sailor. Or this advice from Ernest Hemingway to a friend who's preparing a trip to Africa. Among the important historical documents found here is the ceasefire signed by Dwight Eisenhower, marking the end of the Second World War. Or farther back in time, there's a letter from Napoleon addressing his troops. Or even further back, there are the voting results from the French Revolution, sentencing Louis XVI to death. You can also see Albert Einstein's equations, sketchbooks by Orson Welles, or even a script typed by F. Scott Fitzgerald himself. It's said that writing reveals a person's personality, and in the modern world where most words are written on keyboards, it's lovely to see actual handwriting by people who made history, much of it right here in Saint-Germain-des-Prés.
The Place du Québec opposite Saint-Germain Church features this art installation by artist Charles Daudelin. It was installed in 1984. The fountain symbolizes the ice breaking up at springtime.
Art, history, and writers always in this neighborhood. When we come back, let's check out the famous Shakespeare and Company bookshop and find out where to get English language books in the City of Light, right after this. Welcome back to Lively Literary Paris. Today, we're exploring the streets around Saint-Germain-des-Prés metro station, an area with a long and storied literary tradition. It's a real paradise for book lovers.
12 Rue de l'Odéon is where American Sylvia Beach opened an English language bookshop and lending library, the famous Shakespeare and Company. Here in 1919, she went on to be the first main publisher of James Joyce's Ulysses, and she was a great friend to writers like Ernest Hemingway and Gertrude Stein.
Sylvia Beach closed her bookshop when she was threatened by a Nazi officer during the occupation in World War II. But in 1951, American expat George Whitman named his new bookshop in her honor so that Shakespeare and Company would live again. The new location is just beyond Saint-Germain-des-Prés at 37 Rue de la Bûcherie. The first floor is the bookshop, but the second floor is not a commercial space. Much like Sylvia Beach's original store, George installed a private library here for people to read, relax, and hear writers speak. Often the books are signed by the very authors who came through the doors years ago, such as Samuel Beckett, Anais Nin, and Henry Miller. In exchange for volunteering in the bookshop, Shakespeare and Company allows young traveling writers to sleep upstairs from the shop. George Whitman was a fabulous, eccentric lover of literature. He died in 2011 at the age of 98. And today, the tradition is carried on by his daughter, Sylvia Beach Whitman. George named his daughter for the original bookshop owner and publisher, and you can visit the beloved Shakespeare and Company daily until 11 p.m. It's a unique, essential stop.
Just a block away from where Sylvia Beach initially published James Joyce's Ulysses, there's an English language secondhand bookshop, Berkeley Books. There's a whole lot of bookshops in this neighborhood. You can pop in here and you might even find a copy of Ernest Hemingway's A Movable Feast or James Joyce's Ulysses.
Berkeley, hunting for books is the name of the game. If you have something special in mind, ask the staff to help you ferret it out from the stacks of books, because they really do know what's here. Saint-Germain-des-Prés has a number of excellent secondhand bookshops, both French language and English language bookshops like Berkeley or the Abbey a few blocks away on Rue du Parcheminerie. Usually, in these shops, books are sorted by genre, like literature, art, poetry, but sometimes that's about it, and it's up to you to find the diamond in the clutter. If you love creative chaos, push up your sleeves and dig in. That's what gives Saint-Germain bookshops their charm.
Rue de l'Odéon was a great place to run into literary characters of the neighborhood. It's one of the reasons UNESCO and Beckett, two foreign playwrights working in Paris, had their work performed here. The Théâtre de l'Odéon is an incredibly prestigious theater in Paris. It's where Sarah Bernhardt, the famous actress from the turn of the century, one of my personal heroines, made her debut.
Sarah Bernhardt debuted here because this was the home of the Théâtre Français, specially purpose-built for the Comédie Française. The theater was actually inaugurated by Queen Marie-Antoinette herself. After the Revolution, though, its name was changed to the Odéon, a Greek word meaning a place devoted to music and singing. This new Odéon burned twice, in 1799 and in 1818, but each time it was rebuilt and renovated, while the actors performed all around town in other venues. Over the years, the theater has had to close several times to modernize. At the end of the 19th century, electricity and a heating system were installed. And just about 100 years later, the theater was finally equipped with air conditioning. A bit late, but air conditioning was still considered pretty radical in Paris until a couple of years ago. In 1990, the Odéon was renamed again, this time to become the Odéon Theater of Europe. But even if the name has changed, the tradition has not, and the biggest names in drama will continue to tread these boards for many years to come.
Imagine the Théâtre de l'Odéon, finishing rehearsal, all these actors going down the street, past bookshops, meeting different writers, different playwrights, and then going to have a beer in one of the cafes or bars on the Boulevard Saint-Germain. In the 1950s, Saint-Germain was famous for its jazz clubs, underground cave filled with chain-smoking jazz musicians. It was really fun. But today, you can still come to Saint-Germain, go to clubs like Chez Georges, which open late at night, and are really fun places for a drink, a bit of dancing, some music, still in these basement caves with tons of atmosphere.
Paris is a city that has always loved jazz music and has welcomed many legends. In the early 1950s, a lot of American jazz musicians were part of the music revolution going on in the French capital. African-American performers especially spent time here appreciating the less racist atmosphere for performers and audiences. Parisians were able to discover some of the masters of the emotive music. Chet Baker, Louis Armstrong, and Count Basie were some of the great jazz musicians who frequented Parisian clubs. If you want to discover the new face of Parisian jazz, you must come in May for the Jazz Festival of Saint-Germain-des-Prés. Along with established artists, this is the perfect opportunity to experience new talent for this consistently dynamic scene. From late-night jazz clubs to the mysterious Da Vinci Code Church, coming up right after this. We're in extraordinary, mysterious Paris, where churches have always been influential.
The Church of Saint-Sulpice is a gorgeous building, and it's also more recently famous because of Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code. A crucial scene in the novel takes place here, not historically accurate, but it is really a beautiful church to visit.
Saint-Sulpice is a particularly prestigious location in Paris. The square's fountain was memorably described by Hemingway when he lived around the corner, and actress Catherine Deneuve used to live overlooking the square. Like all Parisian churches, Saint-Sulpice has had its share of celebrities. Libertine Marquis de Sade and poet Charles Baudelaire were both baptized here. And the mistress of Louis XIV, Madame de Montespan, is buried within these walls. Saint-Sulpice is especially interesting for its artwork. The sea creature baptismal fonts were created by Jean-Baptiste Pigalle, who also created a lovely Madonna and Child. You can also see several murals by a great painter, Eugène Delacroix. Later we'll see where he lived while he worked here in the church. The organ of Saint-Sulpice is from the 18th century and is known worldwide for its sound quality and ornamentation. If you're a fan of Dan Brown and you loved the Da Vinci Code, a visit to Saint-Sulpice is essential, even though the author took many liberties with the truth. The church is fascinating. The bronze bar embedded in the ground is not actually linked with the supposed facts of the Dan Brown novel. The book is fiction, after all, but this line is part of the church's sundial indicator, used to determine the exact time of the winter solstice to establish the date for Easter.
Rue de Bussy is a charming street that's kept its market village character. I used to live near here, and it's a wonderful place to come in the mornings for a coffee, to people watch, and to browse the shops. Welcome to Taschen Books on Rue de Bussy, a great place to browse for gift books and souvenir art books about what you've seen in Paris. The shop is actually open till late, till midnight on the weekends, and it's a great place to hang out after you've had an apéro in one of the nearby bars. They have wonderful art books, all kinds of works that are actually here in Paris. Renoir, Gauguin, Degas, Van Gogh. They've got a great book on Van Gogh. They also have other things as well. They also have, you know, insects and architecture. Any visual idea you can come up with, Taschen probably has a book. Of course, Taschen does some really large books about Paris and other cities, but it's also wonderful and has made its name over the last 30 years for its art reproductions. So, for example, if you're looking for something a little lighter for the suitcase, there's a whole bunch of options. So what's great is, for example, if you've just been to the Louvre or Saint-Sulpice and you're thinking about the Da Vinci Code, you could get, for less than 10 euros, a great small book on Leonardo da Vinci that actually has really well-done reproductions. Simple, easy to pack. Or you could go big and go for one of their more luxurious editions. They keep all of those in the back of the shop. So there's a wonderful Da Vinci book over here. I mean, it's expensive, but not crazy. It's 150 euros, and you get this beautiful book. You'd need a whole suitcase to take it home, of course.
Passion's books have multiple languages. You can get an English version or a French version, and some of them actually have the text in three or four different languages inside the book itself. So you'll be able to actually understand what you're reading about in English or in French.
Stroll down Rue de Bussy, we can take this amazing route through the Cour de Commerce Saint-André, a small, very old street connecting to the Boulevard Saint-Germain. This place was crucial to the French Revolution thanks to its sinister decapitating machine.
This passageway is where the guillotine prototype was first built and initially tested on a sheep.
The small street lets us out near the statue of Danton, the famous revolutionary leader who lived here. A clever, controversial politician, Danton died by the guillotine, and his last words addressed to his executioner were, "Show my head to the people, it is worth it."
This street has also featured in a whole slew of movies, from An American in Paris, all the way to, most recently, Midnight in Paris. This is the Café Procope. Now, La Procope was opened by an Italian, Procopio, in 1686. This was actually the first sit-down cafe where you could order a cup of coffee and talk all night long. It was an immediate hit in the neighborhood, and over the years, all kinds of famous people have hung their hat here, including Benjamin Franklin and Napoleon Bonaparte, who apparently tried to pawn his hat here in order to pay for his meal.
After all this walking and reading, we need a treat. Let me offer you the best hot chocolate in the French capital, right after this. We're in delightful, delicious Paris, visiting an area famous for the artists who've lived here. This is Saint-Germain-des-Prés.
Here we are at Un Dimanche à Paris, which is a great place to take a little break after lots of touristing around looking at literary and historical places in Saint-Germain. I like to pop in here and recharge over a hot chocolate.
S'il vous plaît, je vais prendre un chocolat chaud et aussi une pâtisserie. Le pâtisserie du moment, je pense, c'est un frisson.
Parfait.
Merci. I have ordered a hot chocolate, which here comes in a wonderful, special, old-fashioned chocolate pot. And I've ordered one of their pastries of the season, which is a frisson, which means shiver.
Le chocolat. Oui, la spécialité de la maison, le chocolat chaud.
So this is the original way you present chocolate. You get a wooden stirrer and you put it in the pot. You make sure the chocolate is well stirred up. And then you pour yourself more hot chocolate. It's a little bit tricky. Chocolate is originally from the New World and it got to Europe, first of all, in Spain. It was very popular at court there, and it came to France because a Spanish princess named Anne of Austria, which is confusing, arrived to marry Louis XIII with her retinue and her chef and her chocolate paraphernalia. And drinking hot chocolate became extremely popular in the 1600s in Paris. This is the boutique part of Un Dimanche à Paris, and it's a great place to pick up a souvenir of your chocoholic experience here. Now, this is part of Un Dimanche à Paris' theory about adding chocolate to savory food. So you've got pink peppercorns wrapped in chocolate, you've got fennel wrapped in chocolate, plain pepper in chocolate, coriander in chocolate, which they recommend sprinkled on curries. It sounds really interesting. And rosemary rolled in chocolate. Now they recommend the rosemary in chocolate on lamb, which I can almost imagine that might be good actually. And I have to say they're delicious just to eat by themselves. A little hit of flavor and chocolate. And they come in great little packages, perfect for taking home. Now, if you're a fan of the hot chocolate they make here, you can actually buy a tablet from their kitchen to take home with you. Wonderful quality chocolate, complete with instructions on how to make the hot chocolate their way, which is to chop it up and then slowly bring it up to heat with milk.
The chocolate should keep us going for a little while. Let's go work off the pastry by continuing our stroll through the neighborhood.
This is one of my favorite streets in Saint-Germain-des-Prés. It's called Saint-André-des-Arts, and we're just below a statue of the patron saint of the arts, Saint-André. And this street is wonderful because there's all kinds of intriguing historical, artistic details just down here. This building behind me from the 1700s actually hides a much older building. And in the older medieval building, that's where Louis XI's doctor used to live. And for some reason, his house was known as the Maison de l'Elephant, the House of the Elephant. We're not too sure why. This is where Louis XII lived before he was crowned king. There's another king coming up. Intersection of two really historic streets, Rue des Grands Augustins and Rue Saint-André-des-Arts. And the street sign for Saint-André-des-Arts right at this corner is really interesting because during the revolution in 1789, the people of Paris were so angry at the church and at the king that any street that was named for a saint, they actually got up on ladders and chipped the stone word saint off the sign. So on this one corner, Saint-André-des-Arts is just André-des-Arts. Let's go on down Grands Augustins and check out our next king. Mariage Frère is the oldest tea merchant in Paris. And if I were in the middle of shopping, I would pop in and buy myself some of their fabulous tea. But I'm in the middle of history right now. I actually used to live on Rue des Grands Augustins in a tiny little apartment right here, beside the famous historical studio of Picasso, where he painted the very moving, huge painting Guernica about the Spanish Civil War. And just over here is where Louis XIII was drinking, and they found the young prince and brought him out into the street, sat him on a chair, and formally crowned him king, because his father, my favorite king, Henry IV, had just been assassinated. So it took them an hour to find Louis XIII and declare him King of France. This is the lovely Place de Fustembourg, which Ernest Hemingway loved to walk through. It's especially romantic these days when a cellist sets up in the middle of the square and beautiful music wafts down the little streets. In the corner of Place de Fustembourg, there's the lovely small museum dedicated to the painter Eugène Delacroix, who lived and worked here while he was painting the interiors in the nearby church Saint-Sulpice. Eugène Delacroix is the painter who best embodies the romantic movement of the 19th century. Among his most famous paintings is The Bark of Dante, a painting that caused a scandal when it was unveiled. And let's not forget Liberty Leading the People, inspired by the Revolution of 1830, or The Death of Sardanapalus, another tableau that prompted a passionate response from art critics. Despite or maybe because of the critical uproar, Delacroix sold many paintings to the French state. He was revered by his contemporaries. Among his greatest admirers were poets Charles Baudelaire and Théophile Gautier. Delacroix also influenced the next generation, Cézanne, Degas, and Van Gogh. We're in the house where Delacroix lived part-time from 1857 until his death in 1863. He loved this house, and it was conveniently close to the Saint-Sulpice church where he was painting murals. The personal items donated by his descendant to the museum include a palette and easel and recipes for paint mixtures used to make his paintings. It's always fascinating to visit places once occupied by great artists. They're usually places full of emotion, and I find this house of Eugène Delacroix very moving.
Now, Delacroix spent his life sketching and studying the human body for his art, but in a nearby building of Saint-Germain-des-Prés, there's a medical museum dedicated to a different kind of study of the human body. Because Saint-Germain-des-Prés is known not only for its artists, but also for the great University of Paris. The museum is a unique collection of surgical instruments telling the history of medicine from ancient times until the 19th century. Some of the instruments are rather impressive and downright terrifying, such as the special saws used to amputate limbs. Among the many attractions on display here is the prosthetic iron arm from the 17th century and tools used by the doctor who performed the autopsy of Napoleon after his death on the island of St. Helena. The collection includes more than 1,500 objects as well as hundreds of prints and photos. After visiting this museum, a trip to a 21st century hospital might seem less intimidating. But after all this, I need a beer to help me recover my sang-froid. Let's drop by the Brasserie Lip right after this. We're in creative, cultivated Paris, visiting the Brasserie Lip near metro station Saint-Germain-des-Prés.
The Brasserie Lip is famous for its beautiful Art Nouveau interior. It's also the place that Ernest Hemingway had a wonderful meal in the 1920s, and he describes his time here in his memoir, A Movable Feast.
To understand the reasons for the Brasserie Lip's success, you just have to say hello to the bar's director, Claude Guittard.
If you go to a restaurant, it's open lunchtime or dinner time, and it's closed in between. Brasserie, it's open all day, from 8 in the morning for breakfast until 1 at night, and you can have dinner or lunch or even light supper. There's always somebody in the kitchen.
Which was one of the reasons Hemingway loved to come here, because it wasn't too expensive, it was open, he had space to write. So you know what I'm going to do here is I'm going to have a meal like Hemingway did.
That's a good idea.
So my plan this evening is to have the same meal that Hemingway had here and that he wrote about in A Movable Feast, because as a writer, I've grown up loving the book A Movable Feast, which is Hemingway's memoir about his years in 1920s Paris. They have the bière lip, which is probably what I'm going to have because I suspect that's what Hemingway would have had. They have a demi, and usually he ordered the demi, even though they also have a big beer, which is called Le Sérieux, but I'm not sure I feel that serious. So I've been looking at the menu, and there's an entire side of wines and beers, and I know Hemingway would have spent a lot of time on that side of the menu, but I'm really hungry, so I'm on the food side. And I'm looking at filet d'anchois, pomme à l'huile. Bonjour. Bonsoir. Hi. How are you?
Fine, you.
Very hungry.
Good choose.
I would like the choucroute garnie, please.
And you want something to start it?
No, but I would love a beer to go with that, please. I'll have a demi lip, please.
Small one?
Yes, please. Actually, because we're at the Lip, I brought my copy of A Movable Feast. So what I want to do is think about Hemingway in Lips. In this part of A Movable Feast, he gets some money in the mail. So he comes to Lips to spend the money on some beer and some food. He says, the beer at Lips was very cold and wonderful to drink. The pomme à l'huile were firm and marinated, and the olive oil delicious. I ground black pepper over the potatoes and moistened the bread in the olive oil. And after the first heavy draft of beer, I drank and ate very slowly. The choucroute, fabulous. Yes, please. Thank you. Excellent. Super traditional Alsatian choucroute, which is a real hearty, non-dressy sort of meal. So it's perfect to have with beer and the ghost of Hemingway, especially when one is really hungry, which I am. And the waiter very kindly is getting me some bread. I've got mustard and set. Bacon thin. Sausage. Very traditional.
Some
merci, monsieur. Ah, perfect. More mustard. I've actually been thinking about Hemingway since I was a kid, because we had to read some of his stories in school. And I realized the book about Paris was accessible and fun and very inspiring to a young writer. So it's a bit of a dream to be here eating a meal that he would have highly approved of. That was a wonderful day in Saint-Germain, exploring the neighborhood of artists and writers and amazing historical figures. And I especially like finishing up the evening with the ghost of Hemingway. Let's see what we can get up to next time at Paris Next Stop.